collisional narrowing and dynamical decoupling.
Okay, thank you very much. So I want to thank the organizers, do you hear me? For inviting me. I come from Israel, which is far, far away. So if you want to know how far, if you imagine Earth as a Bloch sphere, and Israel would be a horizontal polarization, this would be vertical polarization. So we're almost 12 hours difference. And this work was done basically by my students. Yoav Sagi did most of the work. He's now a postdoc in Jena with Debbie Jean. Ido Almog is stayed. Rami Pugach and Miri Brook has also graduated. This is done in collaboration with two theory groups, Michael Eisman, who's a visitor from Princeton, and the Kuritsky group also from Weizmann. So what you see here is a trapped cloud of atoms. The temperature is standard, few microkelvins. This is rubidium atoms. You have roughly a million atoms here, not just a sample of atom. And it's sitting in an optical trap. And the density is quite high. It's on the order of 10 to the 13, 10 to the 14 atoms per centimeter cube. This is about 4 or 5 orders of magnitude denser than the atomic fountain. So if you go to experts in atomic physics, which know a lot about long coherence time, they will tell you two things. First, never trap the atoms, keep them free. So they have the fountain, which they throw up, and then it goes down to be able to interrogate it. And secondly, keep the density low. So in even in these low densities of optical fountains, the interaction between the atoms is the main enemy that limits the performance of atomic clocks. OK, and I'm going to concentrate on the opposite regime. I'm going to show you very dense atoms, again, almost a million times denser than these optical fountains, atomic fountains. And to get this high density, I need to do a trap. And indeed, you will see that to get long coherence time in this regime is a challenge. So first, what I want to do is to tell you why we bother, why we do the opposite, why we use a trap, and why we work at these high densities. So for this audience, I will use this example of a quantum memory. So people have showed that you can map a quantum state of a photon onto an atomic ensemble where you use the collective interaction. So the photon doesn't interact with each particular atom, but provides some collective excitation. It's sometimes called a Dickey state in the atomic system. And for that, you need the optical density of the cloud to be high. So this is the optical density. 100 means that it's really dense. And this is the fidelity of the atomic memory. So you see that you have to get low errors, you need high optical densities. So you need high densities to couple effectively a photon to this atomic ensemble. So we have to go to high densities. We have to go to traps. There are several other motivations, which I'll skip for this audience. You can achieve strong linearity per photon. Namely, one photon can set a pi phase shift on another photon in these kind of systems, which combine high densities and long coherence time or narrow spectra. You can collectively couple such an ensemble to a superconducting qubit. People have done similar things. You can make clocks, which are portable. And I will stress this aspect of the problem. This is a unique model system. So what will I show you? The high density means that the atoms interact with each other. They collide. They induce phase shifts on the other. So it's an interesting many-body system. At the same time, they are very, very well isolated from environment. So people here before and even after me will tell you a lot how to isolate your two-level system from the environment. An environment is typically dirty. It's composed of magnetic noise. It's composed of dielectrics. We heard similar examples. In this system, the environment of one of the atoms is all the other atoms in the system. So environment, if you think of a two-level system as one atom, but we understand it very well. So we are going to study a system that we understand very well, but I hope you'll see that it's worthwhile because we can really establish the tools that we are using. Just to give you, to orient you to what is our experimental system, so we have a rather standard cooling and trapping scheme of rubidium. This is our optical trap. It's these two coarse YAG beams. So it's a very far detuned. You don't scatter photons. We do all the standard cooling scheme and some less standard cooling ones. And typically what people do in such setups, they achieve Bose-Einstein condensate. So you've probably seen this velocity distribution pictures many, many times. This is the peak of a Bose-Einstein condensate. But in this talk, I'm going to concentrate on a thermal cloud. So a cloud quite close to BEC. The phase space density, if you know what it is a few percent, where one is a Bose-Einstein condensate. So we are cold, we are dense, but it's a classical cloud. So I will use mostly classical language to describe the motion of the atom. even though they are not far from the quantum degeneracy. So what is our two-level system? This is the ground state manifold of rubidium. This is the hyperfine splitting, 6.8 gigahertz, often called the clock transition. Why is it called the clock transition? Because it is used for clocks. For example, all the GPS clocks use this transition. Why do they use this transition? Because it's very well characterized and very accurately measured, okay? We are going to use a modification. So this is the, one of the, our levels, and this is the other one. This is called 1 minus 1, and this is called 2-1. So actually, you see that we need two photons to connect them. So we have to drive. This would be our control. It's a microwave photon and an RF photon. There are technical advantages of using these two levels rather than the more commonly known zero-to-zero transitions. One of them is that this particular magnetic field, which is called magic magnetic field, this transition is Zeeman insensitive. Okay? So we're really insensitive to magnetic noises and the atom are neutral. We are insensitive to electric noises. So we are very related. In all the talk, I will not discuss at all interaction with environment. When I say environment, I mean the other atoms in the trap which interact and collide with my atom. And this is the kind of Rabi oscillation we can impose. And we have a fidelity per pulse much better than 99.9%, as was mentioned. So it's microwave regime. We know how to control very well. So we are at a high density, and we're going to be interested in the effects of collision, okay? And the collision will affect us in several ways. As it said here, it's good, it's bad, and it's beautiful. So first I'll show you that collisions are good. They're good in the sense that they can improve the coherence time. And this we call collision narrowing, similar to motional narrowing in NMR, which I'll briefly review. I'll show you that cold collision, when cold atoms collide, this is a very unique type of collision. And in particular, a single collisional event completely randomize the motion of the atom. This is called S-wave scattering, if you heard. So it's a different kind of fluctuations, and they are discrete in nature. An event completely randomize your spectra among a distribution. It's like popcorn noise. Collisions are also bad, not only good. They are bad if you want to do echo. Suppose you have some inhomogeneity. As people showed before, you can easily correct it with an echo if it's stationary. But because of collision, the environment of our two-level system changes as a function of time, so echo will fail, and we'll have to do many echo pulses, or in this community, it's called dynamical decoupling, and I'll show you how to understand and optimize the dynamical decoupling in the presence of collision. And finally, collisions are sort of a bath, and bath, as was also mentioned before, can be characterized by a spectral function. So we have a very clean spectral function. It's a Lorentzian. It comes from the Fourier transform of the correlation function, which is for Poisson process, for collision, is exponentially decaying. So we can measure it, and we can optimize the dynamical decoupling for this particular bus that we have. So I'm starting with the good collisions, collisions that help us. The notion of fluctuations which help is very, very old. I think origins from this paper by these very, very famous people. And what they realize is when you do NMR on a liquid, you get much narrower lines than when you do it on a solid. Many orders of magnitude narrower. And they realize that this is the result of the fluctuations, the fact that the inhomogeneous environment of a molecule is changing as the molecule is moving, okay, average to a large extent the inhomogeneity. So it's like a self-made echo or a randomized dynamical decoupling. The system is performing on itself. And this was later demonstrated in many other type of systems, quantum dots, microcavities, et cetera. And we are going to show our own version. And the reason we are going to this, first, it's useful, it will help us. And secondly, as I said, we have a control system. So we are not fighting a very complicated environment, but we are fighting the collisional bus spectrum, which we understand very well. And we can control. So what is the system? So this is, again, the trap. This is one, the other level. And what I'm showing you here, that the trapping potential acts differently on our two internal states. So you see the level separation depends on the position because of the trap, and I exaggerated. Here I made a 50% difference. In the real optical trap that we use, the difference is tiny. It's on the order of 10 to the minus 5. But still, being an atomic clock, we are always limited by very small effects, and we have to fight them. So the fact that an atom is sitting at a high energy level means that it has a high level separation, and if it's sitting at a low energy level, it has a low separation. This is a result of the trap. Nobody knows how to make a perfect trap in the sense that it does not distort the energy levels. We do our best, but it's not perfect. So what happens? If there are no collisions at low density, every atom has a different frequency. In reality, the atoms are oscillating in the trap, so you could think that the frequency is a function of time, but this is averaged. Or think of a quantum picture where an atom is stationary. Okay? So each arrow here, this is the phase as a function of, and we have linear lines where the slope is the frequency of each atom, and it differs. So this atom has this slope, this atom has that slope, and you see that as a function of time, we get a spread in the phase distribution. And when this distribution becomes wide, say pi radian, we have dephasing. On the contrary, if you look here and now you have collisions between the atom, that means that an atom starts with some slope, and then after some time it collides with another atom. So let's say it was hot, and now it collides with the other atom, so it becomes colder, so the slope changes. So you can see that now we have, instead of linear slopes, we have this sort of diffusion in phase space. You go up, down, which means that the width of the distribution grows not linearly with time, but only square root with time. So it's slower, which is good. So this is what we measure. In order to measure the width of the distribution as a function of time, we do what is called the Ramsey spectroscopy. As many people here said, we prepare a coherent super. This is done with so-called pi over 2 pulse. We put our state in the equator of the Bloch sphere. Then we wait a variable amount of time, and then we map the coherence on population, and we measure the population with the second pi over 2 pulse, which is shown here. So you see, this coherent superposition acquires a phase. And when this phase becomes distributed, widely distributed, we lose the Ramsey fringes. So here are the fringes, and this is low density. So the collisions here are low. This is 3 collisions per second, and this is 10 times higher densities. All the other parameters are the same. And what you typically see, you see there's an envelope to the Ramsey fringes, which corresponds to decoherence in this example after, say, 100 milliseconds or so. Also, you see that when you increase the density, initially you get roughly the same decoherence, and about here, this is about the time of the first collision, you see that the decoherence becomes slower. So even with your naked eye, you see that high density, the coherence time is longer than the low density. Okay, so we get longer or narrower spectrum induced by collisions. If you look carefully, you can see also that the shape of the decoherence, the shape of the coherence function changes. So we start roughly with a Gaussian. This is not a general rule. This depends on the system. Typically, the decoherence is a Fourier transform of the spectrum without collision. So here we have roughly a Gaussian spectrum. We have roughly a Gaussian decoherence. And here it goes all the way to the noise level. But here, at some point, the Gaussian goes into a linear slope, which is an exponent. So this is non-universal. This depends on the shape of the distribution. This is the expression relating coherence, which is the average of this off diagonal phase. And this is, it relates to the width of the distribution in this way. So you see, when it's linear, it goes like a Gaussian. When it's square root, it goes like an exponent. And this exponential decay is universal. It does not depend. The system forgets the original spectrum, and it only refers to the correlation time of fluctuations. In our case, I remind you, the fluctuations are collision with other atoms. This is Poisson process. We know exactly what the correlation function is. It's exponent. So we get an exponential decay. This is universal. So now we repeat this measurement. We measure this decay time in the exponential regime. So this is what we measure, the decay time. And here we change many parameters. For example, we change the density. So this is the collision rate. And we change the temperature. When we change the temperature, we change the inhomogeneous decay time. So this corresponds to the decay time at low density when there's no collisions. And what I hope that I convince you is that collision, this is the rate of collision, increase the coherence time, as you see it here, it increases linearly. And also the collision time depends, because it's a diffusion process, so it depends on the square of the inhomogeneous decay time without collision. Okay? And this is what you expect naively, and this is what our measurements see. So we see linear slopes. As you increase density, you improve coherence time, and we see the expected behavior as a function of the inhomogeneous decay time. What is sort of nice here is that you can see there's a simple moral to this story. The moral is, if you want long coherence time, you want two things. First, you want small inhomogeneity. For our system, it means low temperatures, because the temperature changes the inhomogeneity, how much inhomogeneity of the trap you sample. And also, we want high density. So what is the combination of low temperature and high density? In our field, it's called phase space density. And you can see that we have data collapse. So this is indeed a universal system. All that you have to know is what is the phase space density and some atomic constants. And as you change the phase space density, you see all these different densities and temperature collapse on this linear slope. So that's all you have to know. Low temperature, high density gives you long coherence time, because density is good in this story. Collisions have the coherent time. And I want to mention very, very briefly that when you go to the high density regime, there are many, many physical effects that occur. I only told you one, that the collision between the atom, this S-wave scattering collision, changes the trajectory, changes the energy. But this is another example. It turns out that atoms interact also by this effective spin-wise interaction. And this has led to this fascinating physical effect, which is called spin phase rephasing, which is another mechanism for echo. I'm not going to discuss it, but I just say now it's a very active field. So many people are becoming interested in what happens to atoms at high density and what kind of effects can actually help us in high densities, which used to be the forbidden regime some years ago. So high density is not always bad. I'll also mention this other experiment, which we did together with the group of Immanuel Bloch. Suppose you don't care about collisions, but you still want high densities. How do you do that? How do you take many atoms per volume, but keep them from colliding? So this is a very ingenious solution. It's called the Mott insulator phase. It's a very, very intriguing quantum state. But for our purpose, it just means that you make an optical lattice, and you make sure that in each side of the lattice, there's an exactly one atom, which doesn't hop. And this is, of course, the specialty of the Bloch group. And then you can use this system, and you can do this coherence and measure the coherence time and store information. And this is the opposite regime. You have absolutely no collisions. So this also exists. OK. So people have thought about this problem before. And these are two names of people that thought carefully about it. So they are smart people. So and what the model for describing this fluctuating frequency is usually a very simple effective Hamiltonian corresponding to a two-level system. This is our excited state. This is our atomic frequency. And then you have some stochastic detuning. So this is the pure dephasing model people discussed before me. And this is roughly how it looks. As a function of time, if you take a certain atom, the free atom or the detuning from resonance fluctuates something like this. And you pick these values from some kind of a distribution, which I called before the inhomogeneous broadening. And you have to know what is, for example, the correlation function of this stochastic process. And many people assume Gaussian process, such as these people, because then you can make nice predictions. Now, our process of cold atomic collision doesn't look like that. It looks more or less like this. What happens for a particular atom, it is moving in the trap. It is experiencing a constant frequency. And then it collides with another atom. And I also again remind you that cold collisions in the S-wave scattering regime are a very dramatic event. After a single collision event, an atom changes almost completely its energy. OK, it scatters to all directions with the same probability. We call them hard collision, or randomizing collision. So you should think after a single collision event, you have this discrete jump in the frequency, and you must completely choose a new random value from the distribution, because we are still at thermal equilibrium. OK? So let's compare, let's ask what is similar and different between these two processes. So I can take the same distribution for both of them, which is governed by our trap. This is the inhomogeneity. I can even take the same correlation function. So this and this can have the same, for example, exponentially decaying time correlation function. But still, there should be some kind of a difference. Because you see, this is like a continuous random process, and this is a discrete random process. So there should be a difference. And we should be sensitive to this difference, because we are doing very precise spectroscopy. So this is reality. This is what we see in our system, or what we expect to see. And I'm giving you several other examples where people are seeing discrete fluctuations. Sometimes it's called telegraph noise when you only have two levels. We have not two levels. But you see, small systems often jump in frequency rather than move continuously. This is another example with a single molecule. So we like this model very much, because it's very simple. And it also corresponds to our experiment. For example, if I want to now know what is the effect of collision, I can do a very simple calculation, which I'll do together with you. So I'm again looking for the coherence, which is the ensemble average of this acquired phase. So I just have to integrate over this sum of discrete constant process. You see how simple it is. So if there were no collisions, I just have to integrate the phase. So you see the phase is just a constant detuning multiplied by time. And then when I put it into the distribution, as I told you, I just get that the coherence is the Fourier transform of the spectrum. Okay, wide spectrum gives me short coherence time. So when I do this, I just have to sum over these random processes, and I get this very beautiful result. We actually discovered it, but then we found that people know of it long time ago. So these people derived it, and look how simple it is. So all you have to know is what is a Fourier transform of the spectrum. This is the coherence without collision. And then this is the Laplace transform. And you have to know a single parameter, which is the collision rate for Poisson collision. And that's it. And you get this analytic formula. So this is a very simple model. And it's also true in our case. Another nice thing about this model is that you do not assume anything about the spectrum. You don't assume that it's Gaussian. You don't need. It can be anything. You don't even have to assume that it has finite moments. And I'll discuss what happens when we have fat tail distributions a bit later. So does it work? So we take our experiment. We have a Gaussian trap. We can calculate this analytically. And then we can, again, use analytically and get what we expect to see, the decay function. So I'm showing you again, this is the coherence. Now I took the envelope of the fringes as a function of time. This is what we measure at low density. So you see we have a fast decay. And at higher density, we get this increased coherence. And now what I do is this analytic functions without any fit. So we measure everything. We measure all the parameters here. We have no fit. And we can get almost perfect agreement with our experiment. So we can quantitatively, at the few percent level, without any fit parameter, understand the effect of collisions or this stochastic process in our system. It's a good model system. We really understand it. OK, so as I said, we have this simple analytic model that describes us what fluctuations do to a spectrum. So now I'm showing you spectrum, but don't be afraid. Before I showed you coherence, they are Fourier related. So it's the same. So before I showed you increase of coherence, now I'm going to show you narrowing of the spectrum. It's the same effect. So what I did here, I took here a different distribution. This is a simulation. And this is called the student T distribution. And it has a power law decay. So it belongs to this Levy family of fat tail distribution. And I'm taking the tail to be fatter and fatter and fatter, which means that lower and lower diverge. So this is a parameter, a tail, which is 1.5. And this means that this distribution has no second moment, but still first moment. And when we calculate the spectrum, the continuous line without collision, without fluctuations, and this is with fluctuations, we still see this narrowing. So it behaves normally, even though it has no second moment. OK, so it's still narrowing. On the other hand, when I take the tail of the distribution to decay slower, this is now a fatter distribution. The distribution has a fatter tail. It's like this Levy distribution. What we see, this is the distribution without collision. And the dashed line is with collisions. And instead of becoming narrower, it becomes wider. So when the first moment diverges, fluctuations do the opposite effect. Instead of narrowing the distribution, that make it wider. And of course, you could say this is not physical. And in some sense, you are right. But I want you to remember that, for example, the Cauchy distribution, the Lorentzian, already has a diverging first moment. So at least up to some far cutoff, this is physical. And this is shown here. So you've seen this. This is the rate of fluctuations. And this is, the width of the spectrum. So we see that when the second moment diverges, the collisions broaden the spectrum, as opposed to the normal behavior, which is narrowing of the spectrum. And this is the Cauchy distribution, which starts, of course, the Fourier transform of a Lorentzian is an exponent. So we start with an exponent, and collision give us an exponent. So this stays constant. It doesn't change with collisions. And I think I'll skip the mathematical proof, although it's extremely simple. I remind you, we have this very simple discrete model. All we have to do is to sum over random variables. And when you do that, you can mathematically prove, and this we had some help, that at least for what is called as stable Levy distributions, the criteria which I showed you is mathematically correct. So I'll say it again. If you have a finite first moment, you get narrowing of the spectrum. And if the first moment diverges, where Cauchy distribution is the middle, here it is, Cauchy is alpha equal 1, then you get the opposite effect. So this is sort of manifestation of the central limit theorem. If you add random variables, no matter what they are, they always approach a Gaussian. And this is called diffusion. And this would be a sort of anomalous diffusion regime. And I want to give you another manifestation how these things work. So what I'm showing you here, this is as a function of time. And this is the coherence. And let's look here in the beginning. So this is a normal distribution. It has a first moment. And distributions that have a first moment in spectrum, to get the coherence, you have to do the Fourier transform. And you always get this zero derivative. And then you have a collision event. So a collision event in the language of Zeno is sort of resetting time to zero. You forget the past, because I remind you, our collision completely reset the dynamics. They completely randomize the energy of the atom and therefore the frequency. So you have zero. So again, you start with zero derivative, zero derivative, and what you get is that the coherence decays slower. On the other hand, if we have this fat tail and we have diverging first moment, so the mathematical property, what is the price that you pay for having such a wide frequency distribution, you get this infinite derivative in the Fourier. Okay, so you decay very fast initially, but then you slow down, and then you have a collision event which resets time, and then again you get this infinite derivative. So you see that here, the role of collision is the opposite, and it creates faster decay of coherence or broadening of the spectrum. Okay, so now let's go to the third topic, which is we have these collisions, we have fluctuations, we want to undo them. So how do people undo inhomogeneity? They do echo, and people have discussed echo along. And let me show, please look at these two pictures. So in our language, echo is, instead of doing Ramsey, pipi in the middle. What does a pipi do? We prepare a two-level system. Each one of the states accumulate a phase, and then the pipi makes this opposite. And if conditions are static, we get this phase unwind. And then we do another pi over 2. So this is what you see here. And this is done at low density. So here we don't have collisions. And we see the Ramsey decay time. And then we see the echo. And we see we go up from 5 milliseconds to about 80 milliseconds. So we get a factor of 20 improvement. Echo works, because it compensates for the inhomogeneity of the trap, which is static. There are no collisions. And I remind you, there's no environment. If we do the same at high density, so first, this is about 10 times the density. First, you see that the Ramsey is better. This is what we told before. This is the collision narrowing, okay? But then when we try to do the echo, when we try to invert the dynamics, we go from 18 milliseconds, we almost don't gain. So the echo fails because of collisions. And you can think about it, if you have a single pi pulse, even a single collisional event is enough to almost completely randomize the dynamic, which means that whatever phase you accumulated between these two pi pulses, you will not get the opposite phase in the other one. Even a single collision event is violent enough to destroy the echo. So if you want things to work, what you have to do is to give many, many pi pulses. And in particular, the number of pi pulses has to be much larger than the number of stochastic number of collision events in the time. Okay, and the way to think about it is, now I have these many pairs of events. Each one of them we can call echo. For example, these two. And only when there is a collision somewhere in the middle, we are going to fail. And all the other pairs are going to be successful. Okay, so that's the strategy. Just give more and more and more pi pulses, and then most of the pairs divided by a pi pulse will not have a collision, will compensate. Only the pairs where a collision event occurs will contribute. But the contribution is going to go down because the pair is short. And because this is also a random walk process, we're going to get a parabola. And this is what we see here. So here we increase the rate of the pi pulses. This is, for example, it's called the dynamical decoupling rate. This is 40 pulse pairs per minute. And this is the coherence time that we measure. So we start with on the order of 100 millisecond coherence time. This is what I've shown you before. And then we get up to about 3.5 seconds coherent time. With this, this is about 200 or 400 pi pulses. And you see this nice parabola. And again, where does the parabola come from? It comes from the fact that as you increase the number of pi pulses, you decrease by the same amount the contribution of a collision event. But then you have to take them as a square root of n, because it's a random walk. So you get the square of that, which is nice, because as many people already told you, to give more and more pi pulses is difficult. At some point, you're going to cause damage, because your pi pulses are not perfect, no matter how hard you try. So this is the particular quantum state. And of course, we have to show that it's general. So this is done for the two superpositions on the Bloch sphere. This is a x state, and this is y state. And we see that we see this nice Ramsey coherence after, I think, 3 seconds. And it's the same for that. And if you want to be even more strict, we have to do it for the entire Bloch sphere. And this is, as people said, process tomography. In our case, it's a process tomography of identity. So we want to keep the Bloch sphere intact. It does not stay intact because of this dephasing, so dynamical decoupling helps. And what I'm showing you is an experimental picture of the Bloch sphere. As somebody mentioned, we need 12 measurements to characterize a Bloch sphere when the process is linear. I'll show you in a moment. Some processes, in our case, are not linear, and then we need more. But for a linear process, we can characterize a Bloch sphere. And for example, you see after 3 seconds, this process tomography tells you what happens. So you see, for example, that it shrinks in the equator. This is because of dephasing that we are not able to fix. And you see T1 processes, which decrease the population. And this is a more quantitative description of the density matrix transformation. OK. As I said, our atoms interact with each other. This means that if we think of our atom as a two-level system, then the frequency of the two-level system depends in a very complicated way on the interaction with other atoms. And in particular, it depends on the difference between these three scattering lengths. This is the scattering between two atoms at state one, two atoms at state two, and this is an atom in state one and state two. This is a small effect. Actually, it turns out that in our atom in rubidium, these numbers are almost the same, and this difference is only 0.3% of the typical frequency shift people know of. Okay, so we are looking on a small effect. What does this effect do? It means that as a function of the population, if I change the height where I'm along the Bloch sphere, I get a different frequency, and this is manifested sphere rotating at a different rate. So you see what the Bloch sphere is doing is it's twisting. So it's not a hard sphere anymore as before. It is not only rotating and shrinking, it is twisting. And it's very interesting to measure this twist because this is actually a squeezing operator and is important to know. So we can measure it using dynamical decoupling. It's a very small effect. Fortunately for us, what we are doing with dynamical decoupling, we are taking a state here, and then with the pi passes, we go boom, 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 boom. So we're changing the sign. What we are doing, we are nulling all the other perturbation except this one, because this perturbation depends on the sign of the population. If it's here and if it's here, it has the opposite sign. So it's like making a lock-in amplifier. We are modulating the population of the atom with the pi pulses, and by that, we are only sensitive to something which changes with the population, and this is the nonlinear effects. All the linear effects go away, and we have initial results, which seems to be in agreement with the theory, but it's still preliminary. Okay, so I used very naive language to describe you the collisions, but as I said, we have an exact mathematical model for them, which we understand very well. So let me remind you again, you've seen this picture already two or three lectures. This is called the overlap integral. What is the overlap integral? Under some assumptions, which are not always correct, you can look on the coherence or the dephasing as a function of an overlap between two spectral functions. This S, which you see here, is the spectral function of the bath. This is the Fourier transform of the time correlation function of the fluctuations. And as I told you several times, we know what it is for our collision model. And this is your system. This is the system, and the system depends on what you do. It depends on your control. So this is manifested here. So what we want to do now, and Dieter Suter will tell us on a similar measurement that he's done, we want to characterize S. And for that, what we want to do is to choose a very simple filter. And the simple that we know is a delta function. And how do you achieve a delta function? You take your system, and you excite it with a continuous Rabi pulse. So it's not pi pulses. It's just a long pi pulse, which takes your system up and down and up and down. And this gives you a delta function with this T square centered around the Rabi frequency that you use. So now what happens if we convolve a delta function with an unknown function? You just get that the decay depends on the spectral function only. OK, so this is what we do. We modulate our system at a given Rabi frequency omega, and we measure the decay. And this gives us 1 point. And then we do it again, and this gives us another point. And this gives this following graph. So this is the Rabi frequency that we use. This is the decay rate that we measure. So each point here is a whole measurement of decay that you've seen before. And let me show you. The green points are our data. So you see there's interesting structure. It's non-monotonic. And then we have two. Let me actually skip the red ones and only concentrate on this simulation. This is theory. And as I said, we have a good theory for our system. So what you should do, you should compare the theory, again, with no fit parameters, to the green dots. And you see that there's an interesting bus. Here's the Lorentzian, I promise you. I remind you again, why do we have Lorentzian spectrum? Because it's a Fourier transform of a correlation function of a Poisson process. It's as simple. But here you see a little bit of a surprising feature. This comes from the oscillation frequency in the trap. So I told you several times, forget about the motion of the atom, which was true in this regime. which we concentrated so far, but you see that if you modulate your system very far, you get in resonance with another resonance frequency of the system. So this is roughly the oscillation frequency where the atoms are moving, and if you drive the system with Rabi oscillation at that frequency, you see that actually, instead of reducing the decoherence rate, you get this resonance. So we can, if you want, we are sensitive to the motion of the atom in these minute details. So now we measure, and let me also mention here you can see that there's a difference between the red circles, which I didn't discuss in detail, and so even theory doesn't agree with itself. And the experiment chooses one theory to agree with. And the reason these two theories do not agree, because in this regime, where we don't modulate the system strongly, it's not weakly coupled. And there's a mathematical definition for weak coupling. I'll say it is the amount of the phasing of the system at the correlation time of the bath. This is weak or strong coupling. So if the system is not coupling, is not weakly coupled, the overlap integral approach is wrong. And you need something else. And this is this region. But we understand that as well. As you see, we have at least one theory which survives this bad assumption. So what do we do next? Now that we know our enemy, now that we characterize the bath, we can try to do dynamical decoupling, which is optimal. And we've heard it in the previous lecture from NIST. And I said the difference here, that here we have a bath, which is inherent. We can't get rid of it because we need many atoms, and they collide. There's nothing we can do about it, but it's simple. We know and we understand it well. So what I'm showing you here is a bit complicated. This is, now we do dynamical decoupling, and this is the number of pulses that we give, and this is the coherence time. So you see we give more and more pulses, and we get better and better coherence. So let's first look on the data. This is what we get with CPMG. This is bang-bang. Periodic dynamical decoupling, and these are other sequences discussed extensively. This is Ewing, and this is concatenated. You can already see that, you can see that in our system, CPMG performs best. But now these ugly lines here look a little bit ugly because they're not theory, they're another experiment. So what we did here, we took the measured bath spectrum, that's why it's a bit noisy, and we put it into the overlap integral theory, and this is the performance we expect for each one of these dynamical coupling, because we know what is the filter for each one of them, by theory, but on an experiment. So you see that, saying that, the agreement between this experiment and that experiment looks sort of reasonable. At least you get the same trend. And both of them agree in the sense which pulse sequence is better than us. Actually, we can prove this analytically. We can show that for a Lorentzian bath spectrum, CPMG is the best solution. This is an example. Here, you may be able to see it here. This is, again, the overlap integral. So this is the filter function of CPMG. This is the filter function of Ewing. For the expert, you see that the Ewing has no sideband here. It's very, very flat. So had I had a sharp cutoff in the spectrum, as many people said, Ewing, of course, would win. But because Lorentzian is soft, he doesn't like Ewing, and he prefers CPMG. So let me summarize with pictures. So I showed you that for cold atomic ensembles, they have to be dense in order to be useful, for example, for Maurice. So collisions are inherent. There must be collisions between the atoms. Collisions can be good. They can increase the coherence time or narrow the spectrum. This is analogous to this motional narrowing in NMR. But here we can map all the thermodynamical variables so we can really understand it quantitatively. I showed you that the specific fluctuations that we deal with, these cold atomic collisions, are very unique in the sense that a single collision event completely randomizes your spectrum. And this is very different than the usual, say, Gaussian process. And this leads to different predictions. So in some sense, by measuring the effect of collisions on the spectrum of the system, we can tell you if they are hard or they are soft, if we have good enough accuracy. So we can take the coupling between dynamics and spectrum and use it in the opposite way, because we know how to measure spectrum very accurately. I showed you that collisions are also bad, but we can still survive. If you want to do echo, we have to do these many pulses. So this is called dynamical decoupling, and we can get coherence time of, say, 3 or 4 seconds instead of 100 milliseconds if you use several hundred pulses. I showed you that this discrete collision, being such a simple system, can give we can ask questions which we could not ask before. For example, we can ask, what will be the effect of collisions for distributions without moments? And we saw that if the first moment of the distribution diverges, namely Cauchy and wider, then we get the opposite effect of fluctuations. They widen the spectrum, they shorten the coherence time. we saw that we can characterize the bus. This is very simple. The simplest way is just to give a continuous Rabi oscillation to your system. So you have a delta function that you have to convolve with the unknown spectrum. And that gives the simplest interpretation. So we know how to measure a spectrum, and it agrees with one theory and not with the other, but for good reasons, because in this regime, one theory is wrong. And I'll skip that because I didn't talk about that. So I'll thank you here.
Thank you, Nir, for a very clear talk. And we have time for some questions.
So the question was about the Mott insulator states. There are always Brodnings. So in a Mott insulator state, the Brodnings are not so interesting. They come also from the fact that the atoms are trapped in a non-uniform envelope trap. So in principle, if you can make an optical lattice which has an exactly constant intensity, then you will not have Brodning, but nobody was able to do it so far.
What is the definition of the coherence time that you use in the penultimate?
What is the definition?
Yeah, well, how are you defining it? Like, do you take, do you have an exponential decay and find some rate?
No, it's if you want, it's the contrast of the Rabi fringes, or it's the ensemble average of the off-diagonal element of the effective 2x2 matrix.
And it just grows unboundedly as long as you apply pulses? So you can have
the coherence. You ask what is the, I said what is the coherence. You ask what is the coherence time?
Yes.
It's the 1 over EDK time. And no, it starts as a parabola, as I showed. And then when you give more and more pi pulses, at some point, you start to do more damage than you do good. And this was discussed. And we also have a paper we are writing on that. So if you want a better model, then you have to include the noise in the control, the fact that your pi pulses are imperfect. For example, we give 200 pi pulses. Now imagine that each pi pulse has a 1% error. That already means that we have 200 error and we don't know where we are. Okay? So in our case, I showed you, of course, the best results.
You said that the CPMG works best in your case, but I assume you only measured the component along the rotation axis of the CPMG pulses, right?
No, we do process tomography. So we measure the entire Bloch sphere. That's the question? Are we using a pure dephasing model?
No, when you measure decay times for CPMG, you say you measure both components, but did you get the same decay time for both components?
Yes, I showed that.
That would be very astonishing.
Well, it's not for the following reasons. Here it is. So you're absolutely right. One of the components is, as you well know, is the easy component. It's the Bloch state where you put your pi pulses. So basically, now you're just rotating around it, and you're insensitive to error. The other one does this, so it's sensitive to errors. So to get this quality, we had to work very hard. We had to fix all the error that we could. And you're also right that if we increase the number of pulses, then they will separate. One of them would stay insensitive to the noise in the control, and the other one would become sensitive.
I mean, that's what you just said, that the error.
Yes, but in all this data, they are the same. So our control is good enough, so the additional errors from the control do not cause any difference between both of them. Does that make sense?
Not completely, but maybe we can discuss that afterwards.
Okay. Of course, for example, instead of giving pi pulses, as you can see here, we give something which is called pi minus pi. There are many tricks that you know well. Actually, they all come from the NMR community that you have to do in order to give hundreds of pi pulses and not, you know, bang your system.
Okay. I think we have to move on. Thank you very much again.